Hi, my name is Tone Tellefsen-Hughes and I'm a chiropractor and I'm also the founder and the co-chair of the Green Hub Project for Teens. We would like to welcome you to take part in our recorded webinar about the Green Hub, and it's about finding a natural solution to the teenage mental health crisis. I know as well as you know, and if you're working in mental health or in a GP practice or in schools, that the mental health situation in the UK was not good before the pandemic, and it's got much, much worse since. These numbers are from Young Minds from 2021, and it shows that 1 in 8 teenagers have a diagnosable mental health disorder, and 1 in 6 between 16 and 24, they show symptoms such as depression or anxiety, and as much as 50% of mental health problems can manifest at the young age of 14, and 75% might get it by the age of 24. And as a chiropractor, I work with young people every day, every week. I've been seeing this number getting worse and worse in practice before the pandemic and after. And from the BMJ in 2021, an article called The Mental Health of Children and Young People During the Pandemic, it was stated that the mental health of the UK's children and young people was deteriorating before the pandemic, while health, educational and social outcomes for children with mental health conditions are worse than for previous cohorts. And this is what I've noticed in my practice alone, and I'm sure that in schools and GP practices this is what you've noticed as well. And they've also found that the evolving consequences of the pandemic are set against long-standing concerns about deteriorating mental health among children and young people and the inadequacy of service provision. So we come across a lot of young people who've been waiting a long time, and this long time means that they are not being seen or heard, and that is a terrible situation for a young person. So the Green Hub offers a simple alternative approach based in nature. So this is our garden. It's behind the Lux Yard Clinic in Milford in Surrey. It's a partially walled garden, and we're going to explain about it a little bit later in this webinar. The Green Hub Project for Teens is a natural approach and has a three-pronged approach for maximum inclusivity. So the first one is our website, the second is our life skill workshops for teens, and the third is our wonderful garden. So the website was set up in January 2021 when the students were in lockdown and they were getting more symptoms of mental health than ever, and we wanted to reach them. So you will have on the website updated information for parents and for teens. We have a YouTube page and we send out blogs and articles on a regular basis to support teens with issues around emotional well-being. Then we have our workshops, and we have been running them before, and they're all about helping young people to understand how to build their emotional resilience, emotional intelligence. We want to teach them how food and is linked to mood, energy and focus and concentration, and we just want to empower them. We want to teach them about the brain and understanding the physiology of their brain. So the jewel in our crown is the garden. And the garden is just one of those wonderful places that when you enter it, it's been part of the Luck family for 5 generations. It is so calming, it's so peaceful. And this is where we offer workshops where young people come in for 12 weeks, weekly sessions, 2 hours, and they're between 13 and 18. And they're supported by 2 adult volunteers, and they just garden. They're off-grid and they're offline. And they do the simple bit of being in nature, being physically active, being in the garden, hands in the soil, calm environment, supportive environment, and they're learning a new skill, and they're volunteering. And the evidence. Well, you know, the evidence has shown that immersing people in nature, promoting physical activity, encouraging social interactions, which they didn't get in the pandemic, providing a sense of purpose and meaning by being volunteers, can reduce depression and anxiety, promoting recovery from stress and helping people develop social relationships. And this is what we're finding after the pandemic is ever more important. And it gives you a distraction from everyday stressors and demands. And I would like to invite you now to listen to one of our committee members, Dr. Birgitta Gattus-Libben, who is a professor of environmental psychology at the University of Surrey, to explain more of the science about this. So, Birgitta, do you think it's possible that some people might think that therapeutic horticulture or other nature-based activities or social prescription activities is just a nice thing to do and doesn't really have any proven value? Or what evidence have you found in your work that shows that it really works?
That's an excellent question. So there's actually a huge amount of evidence that shows that being in nature benefits people's health and well-being. And it's a classic study, you see on the screen here now, is a study that was done by Ulrich in 1984, I know quite a long time ago, but what they did in their study was basically compare hospital records in 23 rooms. Some of them had a view of just three trees and the other ones just had a view of a brick wall, and they compared hospital notes and how quickly people recovered from surgery, and basically found that there was a significant difference. So just seeing trees through your window helped speed up recovery, resulted in less notes from the, but more positive notes from the nurses and things like that. So yeah, just seeing nature has a benefit.
That's incredible.
And they had shorter post-op stays, fewer negative notes by nurses. They also used less pain relief, so quite a lot of evidence. And this evidence has actually increased quite a lot over the years, so there's increasing attention being paid to studying the positive benefits of being in nature. So you can see a little graph here, you can see the bars going up, lots of increasing evidence. And all of this evidence, to sort of summarize it just briefly, shows that living near nature is good for your health and your well-being. Looking at nature through the window, as I mentioned before, being active in nature, of course, but also being passive in nature, engaging with nature. Any kind of interaction with nature benefits people's health and well-being. So studies that looked at living near nature, so for instance, Kaplan showed that well-being was higher among people who can see nature from their window. They did an experimental study comparing people who didn't see nature. Wells and Evans showed that children who have nearby nature cope better with stressful life events, so they tested both the children and also looked at notes from the parents, and basically found that the children coped much better with stress in life when they had nearby nature. The Fries, in a more recent study, showed that those who have nature within 1 to 3 kilometres from their house have generally left less complaints, better mental health, fewer health complaints, etc. And exposure to nature can be both short and long. So we know from just viewing, just out looking out the window for a brief period of time is good for you. Of course, spending more time in nature is even better. Yeah. But isn't just a short exposure, so, and also virtual exposure, so looking at pictures sometimes helps. Again, actually interacting with nature is better than looking at a picture, but it all has benefits. So Ulrich found, classic study, that stress recovery after seeing a scary movie was faster and more complete when people saw videos of natural versus videos of urban environments. They also found that blood donors had low blood pressure after they had been sitting in a waiting room where they saw nature scenes, and they have shown the same with fish tanks as well in hospital waiting rooms. And driving through a green environment is less stressful. People drive slower when the environment is beautiful and green. And we actually found one of the things that people said in the study that we looked at when driving, the things that make driving most stressful and least stressful, one of the things that most people said that made driving most pleasurable and least stressful was having beautiful scenery. We found positive benefits for reported mental health, actual mental health recordings, but also cognitive functioning. So we know that short exposure to nature improves sustained attention tasks, it improves productivity. So officers with plants in them have recorded higher productivity levels than those who don't. people have done experimental studies looking at just having a plant in an office and performance on a creativity task improved.
Et cetera. Yeah, it goes on, doesn't it?
It does go on. I'm not going to go through all of these details. You can read up on these at some point.
So with all of the science that we have, would you have any specific examples of studies that you might have been involved in or you might think be useful for our GPs, our school liaison officers and referrers who might be referring to us?
Mm-hmm.
Could you explain a few more specific ones?
Yeah, so obviously we're looking at young people. So most of the things I've just talked about, most of them with adult populations, some of them also with children. But yeah, there is also just generally quite a lot of evidence of the benefits of being in nature with for teenagers and children. So this is an example of a review that was done in 2018 of a whole range of studies. And they looked at 35 studies and they found there was a significant impact of being in nature on the health and well-being of young people and children. So they looked at forest schools, having a garden nearby, going for walks out in nature, all kinds of examples. And they found that it was particularly beneficial for symptoms of ADD, for instance, sort of, you know, hypertensive activity. So it calmed young people down.
Well, that's 35 studies. That's a lot.
It's quite a lot of studies. And they were from all over the world as well. So, yeah, some of them have really big samples as well. They rejected a lot of studies because they weren't of high enough quality. So these are really, really good studies. Mm. And then a study that we did a few years ago, well, one of the things we looked at was young people, teenagers in the school. We had 120 teenagers. We gave them a really stressful, horrible task to do. They had to do a presentation to each other about what they liked about themselves.
That's
really, really tough on teenagers. So they didn't enjoy that. So that really increased their stress levels. And then we asked them to rest after that task. Mm. And they sat either inside in a small room or outside in a school. And they could sit inside or outside with on their own or with a friend or with their phone. They weren't allowed to do any social engagement on the phone, but playing games was fine. And what we found was that sitting outside in sort of a green area speeded up the recovery significantly, and especially sitting outside with a friend. You can see that here on this red line, which goes up massively.
You can't argue with that curve at all. And you think that this information should be really widely spread to all schools. I think it can make a big difference to environment of
schools. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, being in nature and the schools is quite important as well, because stress, being in school is quite stressful, isn't it? And not all schools have good green spaces around, and even if they do, so the example of this school where we did the study, the young people couldn't even go outside because the doors were locked, so they could sit inside in the break time, but they couldn't sit outside. After we did the study, they could, so that was a good thing.
Yeah, it made a difference.
So I mean, just another example of a study, again, I won't go into too much detail, but that showed that having nearby nature at schools, being able to have breaks outside in natural environments is of huge benefit to young people. But a lot of young people spend very little time outdoors, and this is one of the problems, and they might not be able to at home, and schools are therefore really important, aren't they, because this is one of the places, if you have reach out to a lot of children, old children go to school,
so if you can get that environment there,
exactly, and if the school can support and help children go outside, young people go outside, that will really benefit their mental health and their well-being.
And what do you find are some of the barriers for providing this social prescribing therapies outdoors? Because what we've found, we worked for a whole year under the belief that we could work with social prescribing for the Green Hub, until we were told that it's only in this area of Surrey for the over 18. Mm. And so that was one of our barriers, and we now have to find other ways for the teens to hear about us. And what have you found for your studies are other barriers?
Yeah, that's a really good point. So we did a survey a few years ago in Surrey with lots of people that provide either outdoor activities or mental support for young people. And we asked them that question, what would you need in order to take more young people, specifically also young people from disadvantaged background, what do you need in order to take them outside? And here was like a list of some of the things they said. Obviously, better weather was one of the things that were mentioned, but you can't really do that much about it. But some of the key things really around the bottom, so more awareness among parents, more awareness around, for young people as well, but also things just like funding and volunteers. So one of the things what we found was that, and let's have a quote here on this slide, so there were a lot of these people said that we know that this is good for young people, we know that it's good for them to take them outside, but some young people find it really difficult to go outside. They might not have any experience with it, so they need help, they need support, they need somebody to take them there, to guide them through the activities. And I think that's one of the key factors. We know being outside is good for young people.
Yes.
We know that they might be reluctant in the beginning, but once they're there, they really enjoy it. This is one of the things we found in our studies as well. But we also know that we need to help them. We need to guide them. We need to support them, especially vulnerable young people. So,
That's one of the things with the Green Hub is that most of the reflections we've had from parents is that the teens don't want to go in their parents' garden. And so therefore a garden that's totally separate from the parents is to do more with independence and their own sort of project and the work that they do.
Yeah, because they want to feel safe, they want to feel supported, but they don't want to see it as a, my mum tells me to do this type of thing. So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
For me, there are five key factors in the Green Hub and the garden aspect, and that is that you are physically active, you're outside in nature, and you're working in a safe environment in small groups, and you are, you know, you're working with your hands in the soil, and we know there's science now to show that, you know, the hands in the soil can improve the contact with the sort of these enzymes that can help to stimulate serotonin. We know that in nature you have fractals, and the fractals can really calm the brain. And they're also volunteering, so that they are doing, it's a kind of a purpose, and it's a higher purpose, and they're seeing a garden taking shape. And so we know that these are five, and there's even more of these aspects. If you have all of these together, that we know it makes a chemical change in your brain for 2 hours in the week. That's a wonderful time when your brain is bathed in these positive chemicals, which will have a long-time effect on what we're doing.
Yeah.
So we don't have the access to the sort of numbers that you have in the Green Hub, but we are getting some fantastic feedback now.
Excellent.
And I just want to share some of that feedback.
Yeah.
And so, for example, one of the girls that joined us this summer was really struggling with severe social anxiety to the point that she would get like paralyzed because the anxiety was so intense. And it was really hard for her to even take the first step to come. But when she came, she got really involved and engaged and really engaged in certain aspects of the gardening. And after the initial phase, she got confidence to actually change sixth form to the school that suited her better. She also now has confidence to go and look for another for a job, which she didn't have before. This is very important socially for young people. We found out that she's an incredibly talented photographer, so she's become our photographer in the Green Hub, and she's also now taken on this new role as a teen mentor. And she personally said that working in the garden was one of the best parts of her week, that she was looking forward to it all week, and it was such a calming and friendly place to just spend a few hours and being in nature and forgetting about her worries and stresses. And she said the garden is the perfect place to just take a moment and relax. The mom said that her daughter was so anxious that to begin with, that it took her a long time to just get out of the car. But then when she came for her first session afterwards, she said she had communicated and engaged with more people she didn't know than she had done in a long time.
That's amazing,
that is a massive change for a young person. The mom says that she knows the benefit of the garden as a safe, supportive and calm space. And she's also happy to come back as a Green Teen Hub ambassador and a mentor. So the mentor is someone who comes back, and they come back for the next cohort, and they just gently help the next cohort to, because they, we've noticed that they are even more socially scared and anxious than they were only 6 months ago. And they can then also become a teen ambassador, which means they can take part in some of our open days to show the gardens.
Mm-hmm.
And for each session, the first session and the teen mentor session, they get a certificate that they can then use for their personal statement and for application for jobs. Yes. And university. So we made sure that this is like a job.
Mm.
You know, it's equivalent of a job. So just because you have social anxiety doesn't mean that you cannot build on your work experience.
Mm. Mm.
And there's more feedback. So one mom said that when he came home, he seemed at peace, settled, content, happy, relaxed. And he now appears to be in a much, much better place. And mentally, and his peers noticed that as well. He's calmer and emotionally much more stable. This mom said that she felt that she was walking, treading on eggshells around this young person before. Another mom said that she's starting to recover from an eating disorder. It is slow, but she's eating more, and also she's on the process of recovery. And she said, I want to thank you for the wonderful opportunity and let you know that it's made a massive difference to my mental health.
So what I really like about the way you're approaching this as well is that you don't just have the first step. So other things that I talked about before is like this, we know that nature, being in nature, has a calming effect on people. So that's the first stage of the recovery, isn't it? And you're taking it further, you're then helping them to grow their confidence, to develop their person, their sense of self, and their strength and their self-confidence, which I think is really amazing.
I think it's from a point of taking someone who's like has broken wings, help to mend those wings, and then empower them to get confidence. And that we are now seeing that through these teens who are coming through as mentor, coming and helping the other ones. So it's been wonderful to watch just this, and we take our statistics very seriously. So in the Green Hub we have before questionnaires and after questionnaires, so we can start to build up our evidence based from this project. It's also a very serious setup. We have a very, very professional setup with our software and our communication, and all the adult volunteers have to go through an interview process, and they have to go through DBS and safeguarding and first aid, so parents should feel very safe that their children and their teenagers are in good hands. So to finish with, we want to welcome referrers like the GPs, school liaison officers and teachers, and local youth agencies linked to CAMHS. We would love to work with CAMHS. We would love to be a holding vessel while a young person is waiting for CAMHS. And so they're validated while they're waiting, and they're doing something really constructive and something very, very beautiful. And we would like to welcome you to connect with us. And it's simple. All you do is to go onto our website and you connect on either as a parent or a referrer or a teen, and we will connect with you. And then we will have a conversation with the parent over the phone.
Mm-hmm.
And then we welcome the parent and the teen to the garden. So they get to go through the clinic into the garden. So that anxiety part is taken out.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then once they've agreed to join us, they sign up to 6 weeks to start with. And they can then carry on for 12 weeks. And then they also get a welcome pack with all our information that parent and teen will sign, so they can see all the things that we put in place, like safeguarding and so on. So our website is greenhub.org.uk. Go to contact us and GP and professional referrer. We would love to work with you. As a side bit, we work on Saturdays. We take small groups up to 8 people, and we can have up to 16 on a Saturday. So we can help a lot. And through that period of time, we can make a difference.
I think you're doing an amazing job.
Well,
excellent.
Thank you so much for listening to us.
Thank you.